So yeah, so thanks John for introduction, and you know, thanks for inviting me here. I guess now I defied the wishes of the organizer regarding what I talk about, so that was the last time they invited me to anything, but well, let's try.
We're gonna still keep doing it.
Damn it.
Damn it. Until you get the job.
Nice, nice one. No, but okay. I will talk a little bit also about what they wanted to apparently me to talk about, but somehow I want to take a different perspective. And one of the main reasons for that is that most of you have been to the bootcamp, and then I spent 3 hours talking about stuff that they wanted me to talk again. So clearly, you know, I should have deviated, and that's what I will do. But still, don't worry, there will be max flow happening here as well. You know, that wouldn't be a good talk without that. Okay. So let me start, and somehow, you know, the point of start is a very simple realization that, you know, if you look at what was happening in the field of fast graph algorithms for the last 6-5 years, whatever you count, however you count, it's pretty exciting, right? You know, you have seen, you know, a lot of new algorithms for like to improve over long-standing bounds, and more importantly, they do it in a very different way that, you know, than the way we used to approach the various problems. Okay, and in particular, you know, one of the central notions in most, if not all, of these developments is the notion of algebraic flows. Okay, so what I want to do today is I want to give you a quick tour through these algorithmic applications of algebraic flow and somehow highlight the underlying connection. Okay, so, and again, I will talk about stuff that you probably either already have heard about during the bootcamp and this workshop, or will hear in this workshop later on. But somehow I just want you to present this, you know, just to give you a quick tour through them in a way that highlights, you know, what is the common, you know, common element in many, many of these results, namely the algebraic flows, and what kind of connections to graph structure we are using, you know, when designing these algorithms. Okay. Hopefully this will be fun. So, you know, well, without further ado, let us just start by defining, you know, the main object of this talk, namely the notion of algebraic flow. So always, whenever we talk about algebraic flow, we always think about having some undirected graph that we are thinking about. And usually we will have some source S and sink T, and then there will be some resistances assigned to edges. Okay, so now when we have the setup, what we mean, like the way to, when one way to get an algebraic flow is very simple. What you do, you treat edges as resistors of the corresponding resistance, and then you connect battery to S and T, and you look at the current that settles there. You know, that's exactly the algebraic flow as we know and love from physics 101. And that's one way of thinking about this. But of course, there are also different way of looking at the same object, and, you know, different ways also still coming from physics. And it's just, you know, trying to view algebraic flows via the dual objects, namely vertex potential. Okay, so according to the definition, you know, one recipe for getting an algebraic flow is just the following. So essentially, these tasks boil down to finding a collection of vertex potentials, phi v, so a real number for every vertex v, such that, you know, when we look at the current that they induce via Ohm's law, so essentially we, for every edge, we just look at the potential difference between the endpoints and we divide it by the resistance of this edge, then we will get some flow on this edge. And then we say that, you know, these vertex potentials give us the the electrical flow of value f that we are looking for if this flow that they induce is exactly the valid ST flow of value f. Okay, so what it means? It means that for every, like for vertex S and vertex T, we have respectively a deficit of f of the total flow and an excess of f, you know, at T of this flow. And then at every other vertex, we have no leaks. Okay, so essentially, as long as, like, whenever we succeed to find vertex potentials that, you know, if we apply Ohm's law to it, it will give us a valid ST flow of the prescribed value, you know, we actually found the electrical flow. Okay, and you can actually prove that there is only one flow that can be induced, one valid ST flow of value f that it can be induced by such vertex potential. This is exactly electrical flow. Okay. So these are the two definitions. Probably, you know, all of you know them. But now the crucial connection from the point of, so this is, you know, we all know it from physics, but no, the crucial connection that makes it interesting from the point of view of algorithmics as well is the connection to Laplacian systems. Because namely, you know, one very interesting thing that I will not prove here, but it's really just a matter of some, you know, manipulation algebra, and, you know, you can check it yourself, is that if I have a graph with resistances and S and T and the value of F, you know, if I want to compute an electrical flow that corresponds to this input, then all I have to do, I just have to solve a linear system. And it's not an arbitrary linear system, it's actually a linear system with a very special structure, namely the one in which the constraint matrix is a Laplacian of the underlying graph. Okay? This turns out to be huge, and the reason why this turns out to be huge is that in particular, there is this, you know, I will not embarrass Dan and Shenhua here too much, so I will just say there is a seminal result, but this is like really, really beautiful result that I learned so much from, that shows that this kind of systems can be solved extremely efficiently. Okay, so essentially, in time that is essentially, well, time is nearly linear, and the solution, well, we don't solve them exactly, we solve them approximately, but this approximation is very good in terms of the trade-off between the approximation and the running time. And so the funny thing, so to say, this is really a beautiful, beautiful paper. It is also not the easiest paper to read. Let's just say, it's worth reading, but it's not, it's like, you know, every hour of suffering is then paid back in many, many, and like a lot of enlightenment. I think out of this paper, that we have now whole areas of algorithms that just grew out of it. No, it was a stock paper. We had 10 pages, and then somehow it grew mysteriously into 3 journal papers, like 50 pages each. But you know, this happens sometimes when you have to figure out the details. But you know, this is great. But then, what was even more amazing in this context, that then there was this beautiful line of work that started like simplifying this, and you know, from this like tour de force it was like for like 3 times 50 pages like technical papers, you know, now in this latest incarnation it's a really simple algorithm that you can actually teach to undergrads. Okay, so essentially, you know, this is a really success story in many ways, but you know, all we care about here is that once we have this result, then suddenly, you know, we got this huge hammer at our disposal, namely we can compute electrical flows in nearlinear time, okay? And this sounds like something quite non-trivial, because if you think back, you know, what kind of stuff, what kind of primitive, you know, can you, like, a nearlinear time when you talk about graphs, well, you can, you know, in linear time, you can compute a, you know, minimum spanning tree, you know, you can do BFS, you can do DFS, you know, all of that, and suddenly you have something seemingly so much more complex and complicated, and you get it at the same price tag, okay? So this is really a powerful hammer, and today I want to show you, you know, that this hammer is useful in many, many contexts. Okay? So now, you know, let's start with the first application of this electrical flow primitive, and this is the, well, anticipated connection to computing maximum flow problem. Somehow, you know, the key connection of electrical flow to other concepts that we are using here is that it actually corresponds to the task of energy minimization. So what do I mean by that? I mean by that that actually an equivalent definition of electrical flow is just, you know, viewing electrical flow as performing L2 minimization over the space of flow. So this corresponds to like principle of least energy from physics. So more precisely, essentially, if I have some fixed resistances and the graph in mind and S and T and some value of F, the way I can equivalently define electrical flow is as the minimizer of the energy over all possible flows that send, you know, F units of flow from S to T in my graph, okay? So the energy here is exactly what you would expect, namely, you just sum over all edges, take the resistance of the edge times the flow squared, okay? And clearly this is a strongly convex objective, so it has a unique solution, and the unique solution is always the corresponding electrical flow. So, you know, so this is the connection, and now the application is that now you can turn, like, you know, when I think about electrical flows, that you can compute them fast. So now you can turn this, you know, L2 minimization, this fast L2 minimization given by electrical flows, into a fast or reasonably fast algorithm for maximum flow, okay? At least to solve it approximately. So how do we do it? So this is from, so I might sometimes err on forgetting to mention some reference. I hope, you know, again, you already have seen everything, or you really see everything, so then you can fill up on all the, you know, important attributions. Okay, I tried at least, so, but if I failed, please don't hold it against me. So this is actually a paper, joint work with Paul Cristiano, John Kellner, Dan Spielman, and Shenhua Teng, and except Paul, all of the co-authors are in the room. And now this is the question, okay? So, you know, I give you a graph. Let's say I tell you what is the value of the maximum flow. This is nothing too big, you know, you can just apply some binary search to essentially get this assumption out of the way. And now, you know, I tell you, you should use electrical flows to compute an approximation to max flow, okay? So what could you do? Well, here is a very, you know, very straightforward idea. You know, you are supposed to compute electrical flow, so you have to start by imposing some resistances in your graph. And since, you know, let's say all the capacities are 1, then the obvious first guess for resistances is just putting all the resistances 1. Okay, so we have now resistances, so it is, you know, high time to compute some flow, and of course we should compute the flow of the prescribed value, because that's what we are looking for. Okay, So now, you know, we can do that. And the nice thing about this is that when we look at this flow, then, you know, one very, very nice feature of this flow is that it has no leaks. Essentially, the flow conservation constraints are all intact. Okay, we don't have to worry about them at all. Unfortunately, you know, things are not too good because it is not a max flow. What can happen is that some of the edges can overflow by quite a bit. So, for instance, here we have an edge that is flowing 1.5 when it shouldn't flow more than 1. Okay, so just getting, you know, a good approximation to max flow in one shot doesn't really work because, you know, by just, you know, the whole point is this the difference between the L2 norm minimization and L infinity norm minimization. Essentially, electrical flows, they care about the effective resistance. Like, if you I have some parallel paths, from the point of view of max flow, they do not matter. They are all the same, equivalent. From the point of view of electrical flows, you know, what matters is the length of this path. You know, some of them, the electrical flow prefers more than the others. So, you know, by just playing this kind of effects, you can construct graphs where the discrepancy will be quite big, actually. Okay, so well, that doesn't work right away, but let's try to fix it. And what could be the best way to fix it? Well, you know, whenever we see some edges that overflow too much, well, that overflow, we can just try to increase their resistances and in this way discourage our electrical flow from flowing too much on them. And then, you know, this way we get new resistances and we can just, you know, repeat our procedure and hope that, you know, after not too many iterations, you know, we will get something reasonable out of that. And, you know, this is, you know, very simplistic, and I still find it amazing. It works. Of course, there are some caveats. So, you know, one caveat is that the way we get the final flow is not by looking at the last flow we compute. Actually, I would love if we could do that, but we don't know how to do that. What we do instead is we take an average of all the flows we computed along the way. And then, of course, the way we increase resistances is actually not arbitrary. It's, you know, it's actually chosen fairly specifically, and it's following something called, like, a special, very important technique called multiplicative weight update method, essentially that gives us, you know, how we should increase exactly these resistances to be able to reason about this average of all the solutions that we have seen so far. Okay, but, you know, once you put together these pieces, you will make this very simplistic algorithm work. And essentially, once you add some additional ideas that I will not talk about, I talked about them during the bootcamp, what you will get a 1 plus epsilon approximate algorithm for the maximum flow problem in undirected graphs that runs in time roughly m to the 4/3. Okay? So this is better than the previous work, but again, I don't want really to discuss it here. And, you know, since then, there were a couple of very interesting developments. And again, about most of them, you already, well, we either have heard about or you will hear about soon. So first of all, Li, Srivastava, and Rao, they essentially had a, let's say, different perspective on what happened in, you know, in this technique, in this paper. They have like a different interpretation, different algorithm, actually, that somehow view, like, that properly views this electrical flow as just computing projections in L2 norm over this flow space, and then you get a different algorithm. And this algorithm in particular, you know, had one thing that was nice there is that it was getting better dependence on epsilon, but it only worked for unit capacity graphs. But somehow what I really like about this paper is that it just have, you know, it just views whatever we were doing here in a very different perspective that somehow, you know, complements, you know, the whole picture that we had at that time. And, you know, at that time we didn't have that good picture of what's happening. Now we know it much better. I get it. Then also, you know, Kellner, Miller, and Peng, what they showed is that actually you can extend these techniques that go into like computing single commodity max flow into getting k commodity max flow in time that is roughly what you would expect, namely you're going to get this m to the 4/3 times some polynomial in k and 1 over epsilon. Again, you know, so as long as k is constant, you are actually perfectly happy. This dependence, polynomial dependence, is not the best, but again, it's completely fine as a, you know, as a way of showing that you can extend these techniques to multi-commodity set. Okay, but now, you know, things started to get very, very interesting because, you know, then there was two beautiful developments due to Sherman and due to Kellner, Lee, Oreccia, and Sitford, who, again, except poor Jonah, everyone is in the room, where actually they showed that, okay, you know, just getting m to the 4/3 was a good start, but, you know, you can actually get the full deal here. So essentially you can get a nearly linear time algorithm for undirected max flow as long as you are fine with 1 plus epsilon approximation. Okay. So again, John just gave a talk about this result, and Jonah later in the week will give a talk about this result as well. I just want to sort of give you like a very like 2-minute overview idea of what's happening here. So essentially, one way of viewing what these results are doing is that they take, there is something called like J3-based graph card approximator that were introduced in my paper that sort of allow you to approximate, like give you a very crude approximation of the cut structure of your graph via J3s, which are like just trees with a small number of edges. And now, you know, having this object, you can essentially do two things, and that's what essentially happens so somewhat in parallel. And so, like, there's a very nice parable between these two papers. So what Kalliner et al. Did, essentially, they, you know, took the ideas that go into this construction and then, you know, added a lot of new ideas and a lot of work. Essentially, what they got is this efficiently computable oblivious routing schemes, okay? And what the Sherman did, he actually just took this structures J3's approximators of for cats, and got a regularizer out of it. Okay, so he did a way of, you know, if I have a flow, you know, how can I fast sort of penalize it for being, you know, not what I want it to be. And now, essentially, if you know a little bit of optimization, in particular gradient descent optimization, you realize that, you know, having either this object or this object, you know, gives you a lot of power. Because essentially, this regularization, well, both of this, okay, so the way you can use this part is just, you can just use it as a projector that, well, that is more compatible with the, you know, with the geometry of the flow space. So essentially, the problem why you get here, not linear time, but this m to the 4/3, is that somehow you're using L2 geometry to reason about L infinity geometry, and you will always get into trouble when you try to do that. Okay? So, you know, they did this smart thing, and what they did is, okay, if you want to solve an L infinity problem, you should work with L infinity geometry, and this exactly, these oblivious routing schemes are exactly the projectors that allow you to work in the L infinity space. And then once you plug it in into gradient descent, everything magically works. And this similar is true for Sherman's results when he uses this regularizer, which also corresponds to transforming the space, that the geometry that you are working in, and it again gets the right geometry, and now the convergence of the gradient descent is quick. Okay? But this is, you know, so essentially, as already John said, you know, you can view this as a primal, like, L infinity gradient descent, and this is a dual L infinity gradient descent. And I really like the way these two results complement each other. They are both beautiful. And, you know, of course you might say that, you know, once you see that, you might say that, you know, okay, electrical flows are, you know, out of the picture, they somehow, you know, it was a good first idea, but that's not the right idea in the end. And, you know, in a sense it's true, but in a sense it's also not. In particular, electrical flows are still used when you need this oblivious routing scheme, and somehow the reason why they are still useful is that, electrical flows are actually very good algorithms for computing max flow in graphs that are, like, expander-like. In this graph, they work actually great. The problems happen when you have some paths and, like, and long things. And essentially, what this scheme is really doing is trying to deal with these bad cases by just finding, you know, these well-connected parts, using electrical flows in them, and then doing something recursively with these other parts of the graph. Okay, so, you know, okay, this is a bit stretched, but still, you can say that electrical flow are still present in this, you know, in this newest development. But, you know, this is just a little bit of a stretch. Okay. So this is how, you know, this is the all I wanted to say about max flow and undirected in undirected graphs, but this actually feeds into, you know, a next very important connection that, you know, of electrical flows and interior point methods. Okay? So what's happening here? So let me just say a few words first about what electrical interior point methods are. So, you know, roughly speaking, this is just they correspond to a powerful framework for solving general LPs, and actually much more than that. Okay, so how do they work? Well, one way to view them, at least some, like, one way to view some of them is just as follows. So assume that this is your LP that you want to solve. So it's in this minimization C transpose X subject to AX equal B, and you want X to be non-negative. So this is, of course, without loss of generality, you know, like any LP can be cast in this form. And now if you want to solve it and you look at it, you know, well, clearly the problem is with the constraints. And, you know, and essentially you have two types of constraints. You have the equality constraints and the negativity constraints. And surprisingly enough, the hard part here are actually the non-negativity constraints, not the equality constraints. Equality constraints are relatively easy, you know, as Boyd is saying, you know, from Stanford, he's, you know, this is just some linear algebra, so this is easy. So the really hard part is the, you know, non-negativity constraints. And somehow the key idea behind interior point methods is just the following. Well, you know, if you don't like these constraints, so, you know, how about dropping them completely? But of course you can't, you know, can't do just that. This will not be the problem you are solving for. So what you will do instead, you, like, after dropping these constraints, you introduce a certain barrier term to your objective value. Okay, so essentially what you can notice is that this barrier term enforces non-negativity of all the x's, because essentially the closer you get to the boundary, the more skyrockets the corresponding term in this barrier. So essentially this way it will repulse you from, you know, making any of the variables become negative at any point of time. Okay? So now once you are working with this, you know, perturbed version of your LP, with, you know, with where mu is the parameter that describes this perturbation, well, you can make another simple observation. So first of all, well, this you have to trust me on that, is that if mu is large enough, so if this perturbation is really strong, then solving this LP mu is relatively easy. So you can get the solution relatively easy. And the other thing is that, and this is sort of, you can clearly believe that, is that, you know, as mu is approaching zero, but staying still positive, the optimal solution to LP mu is approaching the one, the optimal solution to the original LP. Okay? So this is sort of the two observations that are important, and this actually immediately suggests a general approach to solving these LPs. So what you do, well, first, you start by getting this neural optimal solution to LP mu for some large value of mu. You just said that you can do it easily. And now what you do, well, now you have this iterative improvement step, when in each step you are like, we're always maintaining the near optimal solution x mu to a given, like LP mu for a given value of mu. And essentially what you do, well, you take an improvement step that gradually allows you to reduce the mu while, again, maintaining the optimality of x mu, and, you know, you just keep doing this. So, you know, you take a step that reduces mu a little bit while keeping your solution being close to optimal. You know, you reduce it, you made some progress, you do it again, and, you know, in this way, you slowly reduce mu all the way down, you know, to be very, very small enough that now you essentially have very good approximation to your solution, and then you can either round it or just be already happy with the solution that you get. Okay, so this is like a very, very high-level description of what's happening. And you notice that the name of this procedure is the path-following routine, and the reason is that there is actually a very nice geometric picture behind it. Essentially, what you should do, so assume that this is your feasible region, this is the cost vector, and so somewhere here is your optimum. And essentially, what you, like, the central thing to look at is the notion of central path, which is just the, you know, set of all the optimal solution to this perturbed versions of the LP mu for all possible value of mu. Okay, so this is some path that starts, well, you know, for large mu, it starts like it is, you know, it is around something called analytic center of the polytop that is actually easy to find. And then as mu becomes smaller and smaller, it is approaching the actual optimum solution to the LP we want to solve. And all this path following procedure is really doing, just trying to follow this path, you know, from the point that we can get easily all the way to the point that actually we want to compute, namely the opt. Okay, and somehow the basic question is, you know, how to do it in a way that is fast and requires not too many steps to be able to keep close to this path. Okay, so this is how the method works. And of course, the crucial question here that is, you know, left unanswered so far is, you know, what is the improvement step? Okay, so how do you make this improvement step? It's a nice scheme, but how do you actually instantiate it in any way? And, you know, this is where electrical flows show up again. So what do I mean by electrical flows in this context? So essentially, so here is how you make an improvement step. So this improvement step actually corresponds to two sub-steps. Okay? One of them is a descent or a predictor step, and the other one is a centering or a correct step. Okay? So what's happening? So the first step is this descent step, and essentially it boils down to solving the following optimization problem, in which essentially the way to... Okay, so the way you should think about it is that this is essentially an electrical flow question. Namely, what you are doing is that you are looking over your feasible space and you are looking for a solution that minimizes the energy with respect to certain resistances. And these resistances are just given by, you know, you take your current solution and you make the resistances to be 1 over, you know, like the resistance of, you know, of a variable I is just 1 over xi squared. Okay, when xi is just fixed, you know, value of your current solution. Okay, you solve this problem, and, you know, and the reason why I call it electrical flow is exactly that if you take A to be edge vertexes in a matrix, okay, which corresponds to like solving a flow problem, then this exactly, you know, corresponds to energy minimization, like the L2 minimization overflows. But, you know, the whole analogy goes true, even if this is an arbitrary matrix, and essentially just the electrical flow in this sense corresponds to L2 minimization over the space of feasible solution. Okay. So you solve this problem, and usually, actually, you can use linear algebra to solve this problem, and that's why you can do it fast. And then once you have this solution, so what do? You essentially mix it into your current solution. So essentially, your new solution, your new intermediate solution, is just you take, you know, 1 minus delta of your old solution, and then a mixing of delta of this new solution, okay? And then also, you reduce your value of mu by, you know, 1 minus delta as well, okay? So you do all the math behind this that you are supposed to do, what you will realize that the effect of this setting will be that we manage to, of course, decrease Mio, which is what you definitely want to do, but this is at the expense of optimality, which is sometimes referred to as centrality, of our current solution. Okay, so that's why we have the second step, which is called the centering or corrector step, in which what we do, well, we again solve electrical flow. It's now just with different resistances. So resistances are now with respect to our intermediate solution. And also, you know, here, actually the vector we are looking at is a bit different vector. I will not go into, you know, what is this vector, it's just a different vector here. But again, still, this is just an electrical flow question. We solve it to get, you know, to get this U hat, and now our new solution, which will be our next current solution in the next iteration of the scheme, is just again we take a mixin of the intermediate solution and then add a mixin of this new solution. Okay, and then you can argue that actually now this XBs is near optimal again, and mu is still smaller, so you made progress, and you just repeat. Okay, so this is the way now the electrical flows feed into this whole integral method question. And again, we are not talking about flows here. It works for, you know, any LP that you are solving. And of course, the obvious question is that you want to know is, okay, how big delta can you make? Because this will govern the convergence of your whole method. And essentially, what you can show is that, you know, taking delta to be roughly 1 over square root of m is, you know, sufficiently small that everything works out. And of course, you want to have delta to be as big as possible. And this is essentially the, you know, so a safe setting of delta. And m here is the number of variables of the LP. And this, of course, gives you roughly square root of m number of iterations to get a close to optimal solution. And this is actually a bound that was established by Renegar in 1988. Okay? So this is essentially the classic, everything that I'm saying here is a classical analysis of entropy method. But, you know, the point is that once you understand that these are electrical flows that you are, you know, that are guiding your updates, then suddenly, you know, you learn that, you know, there is much more to be understood here than just, you know, what we understood so far. So in particular, you know, one thing that you should be already immediate in the light of our discussion is that, okay, when you are solving flow problems, as I said, then the subproblem corresponds exactly to electrical flow computations. So clearly, you can make this computation, you know, be executed very fast, namely in linear time. So what it gives, and this is the observation of Deitch and Spielmann, well, the observation and also the result of Deitch and Spielmann, that essentially, once you realize this, you know, this crucial connection, that suddenly you can get, well, roughly m to the 3 halves algorithm for a very, very broad family of flow problems. It's because essentially, you know, when you are able to solve an LP with the constraints that are just some kind of flow conservation constraints, you know, then you can put different costs there, you can get really creative, and all of them will be solved essentially on the same basic principle. Actually, Deitch and Spielmann, they even went a bit beyond that, and they considered like some versions of the lossy flow, which is even something more general. But the point is that at least for all the flow problems that you probably can think about, you can just solve them in a very generic way using this method once you realize this connection. Okay, so that's, you know, so far so good. But then actually, if you dwell even deeper into, you know, what this connection means, you can actually understand, you know, what are the hard cases for your convergence. So when is your step up, maximum step size that you can make? When is it small? And when you essentially, well, when you essentially like look into that, you realize that there is a certain L2 versus L4 norm interplay that is happening, and, you know, and this gives you a guidance that, okay, that you know what the bad cases is, you know what you should avoid, and, you know, you can think about solutions to try to deal with that. And in particular, in my paper, you know, I did exactly that, you know, I did it actually for all the entropy methods, but essentially what I just did there is that I just showed that there is certain combination of perturbing your LP and preconditioning it that ensures that the bad case doesn't happen too often, and you actually can have better than m to the 1/2 convergence. Okay, the very, very big caveat there is that unfortunately this perturbation, you know, permanently changes your LP. So, you know, the same thing I can prove is actually, you know, if you give me an LP, I can solve it faster, but this will not be the LP you gave me that I solve. And for the unit capacity max flow, this is enough to get some reasonable result, but in general, it doesn't really imply anything for iterable methods. So this is just one result. But then there was this like really, really beautiful result by Lee Sitford that, again, they will talk about later in the week, that somehow they took a different direction. And what they just said is essentially they showed that, you know, once again, once you know what is the bad case for the convergence of your path following routine, well, then there are a way of, you know, carefully choosing your barrier and rewriting it along the way in a way that ensures that, you know, the bad case doesn't happen too often again. So sort of like this is sort of happening here, but in a very primitive and very unprincipled way. They do it like beautifully, like somehow they do it the right way. It's just sort of like they realize, okay, if that's your objective, you know, let's try to approach a principled like a principled approach to it, and then they succeed. Of course, there are some technical, you know, details to be explained, but in the end, it works out beautifully and actually gives, you know, a general improvement for, like, essentially it gives a square root of n bound iteration for any LP, not only flow LP, and gives in particular, you know, a m times square root of n result for all flow problems. Essentially, so whatever was work like whatever that Schumann could do, they can do now with much better dependence on dispersity. Actually, the right dependence on dispersity, which, you know, again, improves some long-standing bounds here. So definitely, you know, definitely you should come to the talks on Thursday, right? Yeah. Okay. So this is all, again, this is just a quick tour, so I'm not dwelling in any of the details. I talk about this result much in depth, essentially for 1 hour in the bootcamp, so there's a recording there, so, you know, I encourage you to look there.
What's the block for this unit capacity?
Sorry?
Your result? What's the reason for this unit?
Yeah, so the reason is that essentially, as I said, like I can solve any LP you will give me. The problem is that I will end up perturbing the costs. And when I'm dealing with a formulation of unit capacity max flow, I can tell, you know, I can sort of tie, you know, this perturbation of costs to how far my solution that I computed is from the optimal solution of the actual original problem I try to solve. And somehow, why unit capacity is important is that if I have one arc and I perturb its, you know, its cost, it's cost significantly, then in general, in general max flow, this can, you know, change the optimal solution, you know, by a lot. But in unit capacity flow, I know that in the worst case, I destroyed at most one unit of the throughput.
Any Lipschitz smooth cost function also suffice, or it's really just the unit capacity
material? And it's like essentially, like, okay, the point is that I don't have, like, I have bounds on how many, okay, it's not exactly true, but roughly it is true that, you know, I have bounds on how many variable costs I perturb, but not on the extent of, you know, how much I perturb it. So essentially, whenever I want to estimate the damage I did, you know, the only thing that I could really come up with was just saying, okay, whenever I perturb an edge, I essentially destroy it, and then, well, this, you know, but, you know, if I don't destroy too many edges and this is unit capacity flow, then the distance from the optimal solution is not too bad, and then I can fix it by different methods. This is not exactly what I'm saying, because actually I have some bounds on the extent, but in the end, when you want to get some, you know, some statement about, you know, about distance of your optimal solution that you computed to the optimal solution that you actually to your original problem, then that's sort of what you end up having, like, that you somehow assume that unit capacity essentially was unit capacity. Like, since this is unit capacity flow, then, you know, just like damaging one edge just costs you one unit of flow. Okay, I mean, this is the answer to your question, or?
I mean, I was asking if there's any fundamental reason for.
Well, okay, fundamental reason for, like, yeah. So like having any, you know, I don't know, like if you have capacity 5 or 10, it still works, right? Like it's just.
I can.
Yeah, let's talk offline because I think I'm not sure I understand the question. Okay. So this is all I wanted to say about, so, you know, like, this is probably the most general way algebraic flows are used in algorithms, because, you know, again, LPs, you know, can cause many, many things as an LP. But now, you know, another, like, very, very fun and very rich and beautiful, I think, subject where shows a lot of connections of algebraic flow to other concepts is, you know, is the whole setting of random walks and random spanning tree generation. Okay? So what is the main problem here is essentially just to sample a random spanning tree. So we are given a graph, and our goal is just to, you know, given this graph, all put an uniformly random spanning tree. Okay, so among all the spanning tree of this graph G, we just want to choose one with probability being exactly 1 over the number of the spanning tree. Okay, so this is a problem, and it's actually well motivated, but also, you know, what I care about this more is that it actually highlights some very interesting connections of algebraic flow and graphs. Okay, you know, this is a uniform random spanning tree generation. You can actually, okay, and just one thing is that actually this number of spanning trees can be pretty large. So just, you know, enumerating them all is not really an option. You have to be smarter than that, because, you know, there are graphs for complete graph. The number can be n to the n minus 2. And also you can actually generalize this question to non-uniform random spanning tree generation, in which you have weights assigned to each of the edges, and now you want to sample a tree proportionally to the product of the weights of the edges in this tree. Okay, so clearly when all the weights are 1, what you get is just, you know, this is always 1, so you get a uniform random spanning tree generation, but actually sometimes in some applications you want to skew the distribution somehow by choosing different weights. Okay? So this is the problem. And now the connection of electrical flow to this problem is the fact that, okay, actually, you know, there is actually a very tight connection between random spanning trees and electrical flow. And somehow the key quantity here is notion of effective resistance between two nodes, S and T, in the graph. So, you know, one way of defining S effective resistance is essentially to just, you know, via this algebraic expression in which, you know, L plus is just a pseudo-inverse of Laplacian, because Laplacian is not an invertible matrix. It has one, like a dimension one space that sort of corresponds to eigenvalue zero. But, you know, once you ignore that, because you're usually this is not an interesting subspace to work with anyway, then, you know, you can think about this as an inverse. And then these are just, you know, this is just a vector, like chi ST is just a vector that has all zeros except one at T and minus one at S. Okay, so one way of defining the effective resistance is just by this algebraic expression, and I just did that because this immediately shows that you can use Laplacian solver to compute effective resistance. But maybe more interesting definition is just the following. What it says is that effective resistance between two vertices S and T is just the potential difference that I get if I look at electrical flow in my graph that sends one unit of flow from S to T. Okay, so I just set up a flow, electrical flow that sends one unit of flow from S to T, and of course there are some voltages that induce it, that induce this flow, and I just look at the potential difference between the, you know, the potential at vertex T and potential at vertex S. Okay, and this gives me the effective resistance as well. Okay, and it's equivalent to that. Actually, there's even yet another interpretation, but it only works this way if all the resistances are one. And when n and S and T is actually an edge in the graph, like here it doesn't have to be an edge in the graph, like S and T doesn't have to be connected directly. And then what it says is that in this case, what effective resistance of this edge is just the amount of flow that is flown directly on this edge in the electrical flow that sends one unit of flow from S to T. Okay, so clearly if this is like the only connecting edge, or like the only edge that connects S and T, then all the flow you're going on there, which corresponds to effective resistance 1, but if there is many parallel connections, then probably the electrical flow will spread out this flow among many other edges as well. So there will be only a tiny fraction of flow going over this edge. Okay, so this is the definition, and now the crucial connection is actually, you know, the beautiful theorem, like the matrix tree theorem of Kirchhoff from quite a while ago, and what it says is something quite remarkable. Is that, you know, if I have some weights fixed, and I want to know for a given edge what is the probability that it should be included in the random spanning tree corresponding to this edge, then all I have to do, I just have to look at effective resistance of this edge and just multiply it by the weight. Okay, and the effective resistance is with respect to resistances of edges being just one over the weights that I have. So in particular for uniform case when all the weights are one, all I just do is just you know, for every edge the, you know, the probability that I will include this edge in uniform random spanning tree is exactly the effective resistance of this edge. Okay, this is like a really beautiful and very tight connection. And clearly, you know, once we had this connection, we immediately know, you know, how to generate a random spanning tree, you know, using electrical flows. So how do we do it? Well, you know, we just did the simplest thing possible. So essentially, you order edges in some arbitrary way, and then you go, you know, over like, and you start with the tree being empty, and you will gradually build it. And what you do is, like, for each edge, you know, you just look at this edge, you compute its resistance in the current graph, and, you know, you, like, once you know the resistance, you know the probability with which you should be adding it, and then you, like, add this edge to your tree with this probability and remove it, and sort of not add it to the tree with, you know, with probability 1 minus that. Okay, so that's the first thing to do, but of course, you know, you also have to remember your choice in some way in the graph. So what you do is that after you made the choice for this edge, you reflect it in your graph by either contracting this edge if you chose to keep it in the tree, or removing it from the vertex from the graph otherwise. Okay, so somehow the picture is as follows. So imagine this is the edge that we are considering now, and now we have like these two possible events. So if we decide to actually add it to the tree, then we just contract these two vertices, and this is the new graph we are working with. Otherwise, if we just decide to drop this edge, then we just drop it this edge, and this is the graph we are working with. Okay, and we just keep doing this, and essentially, you know, in the end, we just output the tree that we constructed this way. Okay, so you know, why does it work? Well, it works, as you probably can guess, is that essentially, whenever we do this transformation, we are just conditioning, you know, whatever happens later on our choices that we made before. So then, when you write out the probabilities that if you actually have any given edge is added to the tree, it would be exactly the right probability. Okay, there is just some chain ruling that you have to use, and that's out. Okay, so that's, you know, that's a nice algorithm, but like, what is the running time of this algorithm? So clearly, the only non-trivial thing you have to do is just to compute this effective resistance for a given edge in your graph. And since, you know, since we know that effective resistance corresponds to some expression in the inverse of Laplacian, then it essentially corresponds to solving a Laplacian system. So we can just use Laplacian solver. There, of course, is a slight difficulty because actually, you know, in principle, you need to solve, you need to know this effective resistance exactly, okay, not approximately, and especially since this number can be very small because, you know, there can be, like, exponentially many trees, so these numbers can be very, very small, so even a relative error for very tiny epsilon might be not enough. But then, you know, so that's what we thought, but then Jim Propp showed us, you know, that there is a very beautiful and very simple trick to essentially, you know, that allows you to go around this. Essentially, just having good enough approximation is good enough to get the sampling perfectly well. Essentially, well, for sure, you know, if you can get 1 plus epsilon approximation in log 1 over epsilon time is good enough. I'm not sure if polynomial would be sufficient, but just...
But is it like setting epsilon? Are you just setting epsilon to like 1 over n?
Yeah. It's embarrassingly simple trick in the retrospect, but we somehow missed it. So. Yeah, but that's exactly the trick. It's like you just start with epsilon half, and then you see if you, like, this accuracy allows you to correctly classify, you know, your random coin drop, you know, whether you should include that or not. If not, then you refine. And you can show that in expectation, this actually is not a big overhead. Okay? But, you know, this is very, very nice. So now, you know, essentially, based on that, so of course, you know, one way to do it is actually you can always just use, you know, just the well-known matrix, like, you know, Gauss algorithm or fast matrix multiplication to, you know, to compute this effective resistance exactly without having to, you know, to use any tricks. And then if you use actually Laplacian solver with this trick, you will get m squared running time. So you have like either m times n omega or m squared. And actually, it turns out that the first running time you can be much smarter about this. This is the result of... the reference disappeared, but this is a result of Kolbrun et al. That shows that if you there is a smart way of ordering the edges, such that, you know, in the end, what you will get, you will actually only have to pay, you know, for inverting your matrix once. And then essentially everything can be amortized in this running time. Okay? So these are the running times that you get. The question is, you know, can you do better? And the answer is yes, at least when the graph is sparse. So how do you do it? Well, you actually look at another very beautiful way of sampling random spanning tree. This is due to Border and Aldous. And essentially, what they do, they show how to generate a spanning tree using random walks. So how does it work? Well, essentially, you have your graph. You start a random walk at some vertex S. And then, you know, whenever this random walk visits a new vertex V, you add to the tree the edge through which this first visit occurred. Okay, it's easy to see that, you know, that this will be a tree. And so here is an instruction of this algorithm. So you start at S, you made a move. This is the first time you visit this vertex, so you add the corresponding edge. Another move, again, it's the first visit, so you add the corresponding edge. Again, there is the first visit, you add the corresponding edge, and so on and so on. But here, you returned to somewhere where you have been before, so you don't add any edges. And then again, you have a new visit, so you add edges, and you keep doing this, and you get some tree like that. And of course, you know, the question is, you know, why on earth this should be a random spanning tree? Well, there is some magic involved, or something like it's a very beautiful reasoning called a coupling from the past. So, you know, but there is a way to show that this is actually a uniform random spanning tree. But now, of course, the next question is, you know, what is the running time? Okay, and you know, clearly the running time is roughly the cover time, corresponding to the cover time of the graph. So this is roughly O of Mn, in the worst case. And actually, Wilson had a result that allows to get a bit faster running time. Like this is a running time is proportional to the mean hitting time, which, you know, in some graphs can be much smaller than the cover time, but in the worst case, it's still Mn. But you know, again, this is a different random process, like a similar but different random process that actually gets a sort of like it's always better than the cover time, right? Because like you can show that this quantity is always better. Unfortunately, in the worst case, it can actually be Mn as well. Okay. But still, you know, like, so you have Mn already, you know, can we do something better about this? And it turns out that, you know, that indeed we can. And somehow, you know, the point of start here is just looking at, you know, what could be the bad case for, you know, for this random walk algorithm. Of course, it would be some graph that has very bad cover time, and we definitely, you know how such graphs look like. So here is an example of such a graph. It's a lollipop-like graph, and clearly, you know, it has n squared edges, and its cover time is actually n cubed. So this is the worst possible. Okay, so you know, so clearly this is the worst possible. But you know, if you look at this graph and our algorithm, and you know, what we actually want to compute, you realize something. Namely, okay, so first of all, if you look at what the walk is doing, so essentially it resides mainly in this, you know, complete graph Kn. Sometimes it's trying to venture, you know, upward the path, but you know, like it is taking a while, and you know, that's where essentially this n cube running time is coming from. But you know, most of the time, it spends it, you know, in this graph Kn. Okay, but you know. when you realize that, then you realize, okay, but you know, this kind of these trajectories that are like keep revisiting this graph Kn, they're not really useful to us, right? Because you know, all we care about, we just have to figure out what are the first visit edges. Once we have visited some parts of the graphs, revisiting it doesn't bring any new information there. We just are wasting our time there. Okay, so you know, so here's the first idea. Okay, in this graph, you know, what might be a good thing to do is just to try to cut, you know, this graph over here. You know, then we can quickly figure out, you know, what is the, you know, what is the like the sample of the tree in this part of the graph, and then just focus on the path. And again, this now will be easy this way. Okay, so this is actually a good intuition, but you know, it doesn't work exactly that way, because you might think about a graph that has more than one edge here, and then trying to splicing, you know, different random forests in different parts and getting a consistent random spanning tree out of it is really painful. I tried; it's really really painful, and I don't know how to make it work. So you know, so this doesn't work directly, but it still, you know, informs, like gives you some idea how to do about it. And in particular, this is what we did in a joint paper with John Keller. So essentially, we just try to do, like, to use this insight in the following way. So what we do, we just look at our graph and we decompose it into pieces that have, you know, each of the pieces has low diameter, and then the interface between them is relatively small. So the number of edges between different pieces is relatively small. And again, I'm not putting any numbers here, I just want to give you an intuition. And now what you do, well, you essentially run the same algorithm as before, so we just start running this random walk and looking at the first of these edges with one crucial modification. Namely, you know, whenever there is some piece in which you already know how the this tree should look like, whenever you revisit it again, you don't really simulate this trajectory of this random walk inside this piece, because you don't need it anymore. You know already how the tree works like. So what you do instead is that, you know, upon entering this piece, you immediately shortcut this random walk by just exiting from it according to the appropriate exiting distribution. Okay, so this way, just you are cutting out all the trajectories that revisit the parts of the graphs that you have already seen. Okay, so you know, clearly, since we always wait before we visit the whole piece, we still retain all the information we need. We have all the first visit edges here, like we don't lose any information here. And you know, the nice thing is that since, you know, each of these pieces is low diameter, you can show that this means that covering each piece happens relatively quickly. Okay, so if you look at number of steps inside the piece that are needed to cover it, they are relatively small. And on the other hand, you know, the small interface means that we don't have to look to walk too much on the interface as well. Okay, so the number of steps between different jumping between different parts is not too big as well. So the only missing element here is now, you know, how to actually do this shortcutting. So okay, upon that's not what I wanted to do. So you know, upon entering the piece, you know, we want to choose choose which edge we should exit through with the right probability. You know, how can you do it? You know, it's not clear a priori how to do it. And you know, in particular, what we want to do is just essentially for a given piece D and some outgoing edge E, we want to compute what is the probability that we will exit from this piece via this edge if we enter through some vertex V. Okay, that's the general type of probabilities you want to compute. And you know, surprise, surprise, you can actually use algebraic flows to compute this kind of probabilities. Okay, so how? So here's another connection that is very important. It's namely the connection of, you know, like the absorption probabilities of random walk and algebraic flow. So roughly speaking, what is happening here is just the following. So imagine you have a graph, and you have three vertices, S, T, and V. Okay, and now what you would like to compute is you would like to compute the probability Q, S, T, V, that if I start a random walk at V, then I am, like, what is the probability that I will hit first T before hitting S? Okay, it's clearly a well-defined probability. How to compute it? Well, the beauty of this is that there is a very simple algorithm that allows you to compute this kind of probabilities. So what do? You just compute an electrical ST flow in this graph, okay? And then what you do is just normalize the voltage potentials and shift them so as the voltage potential of S is 0 and the voltage potential of T is 1, okay? So you just shift it and normalize it to just set up this boundary condition, and then what you can prove is that if I look at the voltages that is now corresponds to every other vertex V, then this will be exactly the probability QSTV. So clearly it makes sense for S because it's 0, and for T that this is 1, but actually it turns out to be right for every other vertex as well. Okay, so since we can, of course, compute the electrical flow approximately relatively fast, we can compute this kind of probabilities QSTV for all the vertices V in linear time. Okay? So this is the connection. Now, how do we use it here? Well, you know, it's just an exercise now, right? So all you do is just, so if I want to compute something from this edge E, I just like look at one endpoint of this edge. This is my one vertex. And then I just contract like all the other endpoints of the other edges that are going out as the another vertex U star. And essentially, then you can observe that the probability you are seeking is exactly the probability that starting at V, you will hit U before hitting, or you will hit U star before hitting U.
Okay.
And this is something that you can, you know, that you can just compute using algebraic flow. You just compute the corresponding algebraic flow. You look at the voltages, and you get this probability right away. Actually, you get them from all the vertices v in one shot. Okay. And again, this is just an approximation, but Prop already explained to us, you know, that actually getting this approximation is just good enough to get an exact sampling. Okay. And you know, putting it all together, what you get is just m squared square root of n algorithm. Okay. So this is m square root of n, you know, can you go beyond that, you know, can you actually improve upon this n to the 3 halves? And it turns out at first that this might not be obvious, because for instance, here's an example of a graph that really gives trouble to the algorithm of Kellner, of John Kellner and me and myself. Namely, in this graph, you know, we have just two expanders that are joined by roughly square root of n paths of roughly square root of n vertices. Okay? So what happens, what is the problem with this graph is that its cover time is roughly n to the 3 halves. But also, which is, you know, not good enough if you want to improve upon this running time, but also there is no good way of cutting this graph into the smaller pieces. Essentially, if you try to cut something, you know, you roughly cut square root of n edges, and that's too much to make all the math work to get any running time better than a square than n to the 3 halves. So, you know, so what to do? Well, what can you do to deal with this kind of bad cases? Well, somehow the key insight is just that essentially you have to realize that, you know, to deal with this case, you have to work with the right metric. Okay, so what is the right metric here? So this comes the another connection that is important between algebraic flows and random walks, namely, you know, the connection to cover and commute times of random walks. Okay, so essentially here is again the definition of the effective resistance. And now the two connections we want to look at is just the following. So first of all, it says that the commute time between two vertices in the graph, S and T, is exactly 2m times the effective resistance of this edge. So it's essentially proportional to the effective resistance of these two vertices. And so commute time is just the expected time needed to get from S to T and back. Okay, and this is actually turns out to be very tightly connected to effective resistance. And the other thing is that, you know, this is the so-called Matthews band says that, you know, in particular, this implies that if I have some subgraph D in my graph that has relatively small effective resistance diameter, then I can cover this, then I can cover this subgraph relatively fast in time that is, you know, roughly M times the whatever is the bound on the effective resistance. Okay? So how does it help us in our case? Well, the point is that, you know, once you look at this graph from the point, like via, you know, lens of effective resistance metric, then you will get quite different picture to the one that you get here. Namely, what you get here is just something something as follows. Namely, suddenly, these two, you know, seemingly far away expander parts, they become, you know, very close together. They actually are very close in effective resistance metric, even though they are not connected at all. They are actually very close in the effective resistance metric. So essentially, this allows us to identify a large, low diameter region in the effective resistance metric that has relatively simple exterior, because everything outside is just paths. And this is something you can deal with relatively easily. So essentially, the idea is just the following. So what you do, you know, we just know that since this has low diameter, we can just cover it fast, and you can figure out how the tree looks like here fast. And then, you know, once we figure that out, we can condition on this choice by, you know, by just either removing corresponding edges or collapsing the one that we chosen to be in the tree. And in this way, essentially, we made a lot of progress because we suddenly reduced. These are big parts of the graph, and we essentially dealt with them by either contracting them or removing the edges. So we made a lot of progress, and we can now recurse, and we can just start working with the, you know, with this smaller graph and try to like sample the remaining parts of the tree here. So this is essentially like the idea behind the algorithm. Of course, there is still, if you are careful, there is still some missing element here. Namely, you know, one. Okay, so for this case, everything works out beautifully. But you know, what if actually there is, you know, I am able to identify some large low diameter region that give me trouble, but there, you know, but its exterior is not simple. So in particular, one canonical example here is imagine that I actually have two regions that are, you know, low diameter, and they are large, they're two expanders, but they actually are quite far in effective resistance metric of the graph. You know, in principle, this could happen. So what do you do then? Well, you are in trouble because if you want to condition on one of them, then the other one will give you trouble during the simulation. If you try to condition on both of them simultaneously, then it will require a cover time, which is essentially the cover time of the whole graph. So, you know, there is clearly something problematic here. And somehow, you know, the last missing element that you have to figure out is that you actually can tie this like large distance and effective distance metric to a statement about the cut structure of the graph. Essentially, what you can show is that if I have two big, you know, big low diameter subgraphs on my graph that are far away in effective distance metric, then actually there has to exist a good cut that separates one from the other. Okay, and essentially what you do is just essentially whenever you find this cut, and you can find it fast using max flow computation. So essentially when you just find such a thing, you just can cut along this cut and somehow recurse on both of the parts, and this way, you know, you deal with this kind of hard case. Okay, so and you know, there is a bit more details than I just said, but these are the main ideas. And you know, once you put it all together, you get m to the 4/3 times sampling algorithm. Okay. So now this is just the last quick sort of genre of connection I want to mention. And essentially, there are just two important results that I think are important that show the connection of electrical flows and cuts. So one of them is sparsification, and this is due to Dan Spielman and Nikhil Srivastava. Essentially, they propose a very simple sparsification algorithm, okay? At least conceptually very simple. So all you have to do is that if I give you a graph which you want to sparsify, all you have to do is just you have to compute effective resistances for all the edges of this graph. And once you do that, you just sample roughly, you know, n log n over epsilon squared of these edges with repetitions independently. And of course, you do it proportionally to this effective resistance. Okay? Once you do that, essentially, you know, you have your sparsifier because you just take your sparsifier h to be union of all of the sampled edges. You know, maybe sometimes a multiple copy of the same edges, that's still fine. And you know, after rewriting them by the inverse of sample probability to make sure that the expectation is right. And you know, once you do that, you know, magic happens, and with high probability h actually preserves, you know, the 1 plus epsilon preserves the all the cuts of the original graph up to a factor of 1 plus epsilon. Again, this magic is really just a concentration bound. Essentially, what you can show, okay, well, that's not how you show it because you also care about spectral part, but you could, if you care only about cuts, then you can just use, like, realize that for every cut, this means that the expectation is just right. And actually, you have independent sampling, so you can use Chernoff bounds, and then you use Karger trick to show that, you know, the union bound over all the cuts to get the cut thing. But actually, you know, the proof is even shorter and stronger because it also preserves, shows that also the spectral properties are preserved. But somehow, you know, if you just want to think about cuts, that's one way of thinking about this result. And somehow, you know, the takeaway message from this, you know, from this result that I have here is that essentially this shows that effective resistance is a, you know, good measure of importance of a given edge for connectivity. Okay. And you know, another example of exactly this kind of connection that I want to say is that, you know, the connection that is emphasized when you are thinking about you know, a notion of thin trees. So what is a thin tree? In the thin trees, we assume that we have a graph G that is k-regular and k-connected. So essentially, it's as connected as it can be while being k-regular. And now, you know, we say that a spanning tree in this graph is alpha thin. If the following condition holds, essentially, if I have this tree and I look at any cut in this graph, what I want is that I want the number of edges of this tree in this cut should not be bigger than alpha times the number of edges in this cut in the original graph G divided by k. Okay, so this might be a mysterious condition at first. You know, what does it really mean? But in a sense, you can think that this means that this tree T is like a very extreme sparsifier. Okay, and like it's extreme sparsifier in the sense that roughly, you know, if you just, now, one way to sparsify your graph is just to divide all these edges by k. Okay, it wouldn't be really a sparsification, but at least you would sort of, you know, you would reduce, like, from a graph with, you know, with kn edges, it would become a graph with n edges, which would be great. So, like, sort of, so this is sort of the number of edges that you would expect in every cut in a sparsifier, and then alpha is just some tolerance bound that says, okay, well, sometimes you will go over, and the alpha is exactly the quality. So, of course, you can never get alpha better than 1, but the question is, you know, how close to 1 can you get? And that's exactly the question of the tree. So you want to have a connected subgraph that doesn't overflow any cut by more than it should. Well, by more than alpha than it should. Okay? And the reason why this notion is interesting, okay, it's interesting just by itself, but also actually, this is, by the way, joint work with Arash Asadpour, Michel Gomans, Cheyenne Oves-Garan, and Amin Saberi, and I saw Cheyenne somewhere, but he didn't come to a talk, that's fine. Essentially, and you know, the connection that we cared about at that point is that essentially being able to find such alpha thin trees immediately gives you an alpha alpha approximation algorithm for the ATSP problem. Okay? But you know, this is just a motivation. We shouldn't really care about that now. But you know, the question is, you know, how to find a good alpha thin trees? Well, one way is just to do independent sampling, for instance, by effective resistance. And what you will get out of that is you will get well alpha of roughly log n. And actually, you can show that for independent sampling, this is the best you can hope. Okay, so essentially, this corresponds to just to have your graph. If you do independent sampling of edges, if you want your graph to be at least connected, you need to have this. Well, you need to put at least log n here. Otherwise, this will not happen. But can you do better? And it turns out that there is a better way of doing it. Of course, you have to resort to some kind of dependent sampling. And what it will be here, essentially what you do is, like, given your graph, you just compute the weights WE so that essentially if I look for every edge, what is the probability that it will be included in a random spanning tree with respect to these weights? It should be roughly uniform. So it should be roughly the same for all the edges. Okay, so it is possible to compute this kind of resistances relatively quickly, not super quickly, but relatively quickly. And now once you have this these weights, that's how, that gives you this uniform, close to uniform, like sampling of the edges with respect to the random spanning tree, you just sample a random spanning tree out of that, and you want to argue that this is a good thin tree. So essentially what happens here is that, like, after you computed these weights and you are sampling with respect to these weights, essentially what you are ensuring is that, again, if you look at any cut in your graph, then its expectation is roughly right, okay? Because, you know, if every edge is equally probable, then clearly roughly, you know, every edge is exactly sampled with the probability that you would like it to be in the sparsifier. And then, of course, you know, the point is that, first of all, the sampling is not independent, but actually, you know, the well-known feature of random tree edges is that there is a negative correlation, which is exactly the right direction that you want. Like, it's as good as independence for you in this case. And also, then again, you just use union bound, so you can use sort of like a Chernoff bound, an upper Chernoff bound, and then you can use this Kargers trick to upper bound over all the cuts. And what you get out of this is a very impressive gain of log n over log n, so you gain a log n over what you get with independent sampling. And I encourage you to improve this PFOL. I think it is, like, there is nothing preventing us to have a constant bound here. In particular, well, can we do better? In particular, after the recent breakthrough of Markus Spielmann and Srivastava, Harvey and Olver, they show that you can use their technique to get somehow a result for a spectral notion of a spectral analog of thin trees. So I will not get into what it exactly is, but essentially the bound they get there is constant. So here we could only get log n over log n, they get constant, but unfortunately this spectral analog, it doesn't seem to imply anything for ATSP. But at least in that regime, they actually can get constant. Like, to the point, the trick there is that sort of the assumptions you have is stronger than the assumptions you have here. So that's why you can get better result, but it doesn't seem to imply anything for this.
I think the reason Cheyenne is not here is because he's writing the argument to better than log n.
Oh, really? No, well, I know that he has a paper which, like, gives a technique, but that actually can close it. Okay.
You guys can ask him, he's upstairs.
I will. So clearly, so maybe, if I gave this talk tomorrow, then I would have some better bound here.
Great.
Yeah, so he was working hard on that. So he has some way exactly like trying to transplant the result for the spectral thin trees to this to the result of the connectivity. So yeah, I think he succeeded. So that would be amazing.
Good.
So this is okay. So this is essentially all the examples that I wanted to talk about. Again, I know I didn't really say too much of details on any of them, but hopefully gave you some, like, some tour of what's happening here. So let me just conclude. So first of all, I hope I made somewhat of a case that analytical flows is a powerful tool for graph algorithms that is actually is useful in many contexts. In particular, like, what makes it such a compelling tool is that, first of all, it has, there is a wealth of connections to various graph notions, like random walks and graph notions. And also, we can compute it very fast. So we can get all this information accessible very fast. And of course, the key question is, where else can this tool be useful? Okay, so I show you some aspects. I'm sure there is more. I don't know what they are, but I'm sure there is more. In particular, some more specific question is that, first of all, I think that really thinking about analytical flows and trying to understand the structure is a good way to advancing our understanding of the behavior of the interpol methods. Like, somehow, I think that, if you want to find new ways of, getting new types of interpol methods, you should just first think about, like, the flow formulation of, some flow problems that you are trying to solve with interpol method, and just try to understand how the analytical flows that are showing up there, how they behave, and how to deal with them. Like, I claim it was successful so far, but I think it will be successful even more once you really understand what's happening. Well, the other thing is that somehow this is something that always James has an issue here, but like I still want to claim that somehow, you know, the whole premise of spectral graph theory is that like you have this like eigenvalues and eigenvectors that you can like somehow this is a very nice thing because you can access the information about them very fast, and then they seem to be connected to, you know, to very interesting cut notions and other properties of the graph, and well, they indeed they are, and you know, we have some amazing results with them. But I think that once we have now this Laplacian solver, then you know, the object we should be looking at now that we previously couldn't access quickly, is the electrical flows, and that's what you should look at. In particular, one nice thing about electrical flows is that they are, in a sense, more stable than the eigenvalues. So eigenvalues are like very, you know, they tend to be very, you know, very, you know, very susceptible to noise, and it's okay. Like there are some concrete scenarios in which this shows up. So in particular, Nishit will be talking about his result on Friday, where this kind of problems, like of, you know, why just eigenvector, like having a cut algorithm that is based only on eigenvector, like what are the problems with that when you want to have fast running time, right? So this is the result with
kind of a relay going on.
Sorry?
I mean, I'm not going to be talking about that result aspect.
Shame.
What I advertise, so.
No, you said that there is okay, yeah, sure, okay. But, okay, what you were looking about stemmed out of the result that I'm talking about, okay? So that will be my defense. That's actually a shame, because I think there was actually, if you wanted to have some, you know, better point about why this makes sense, it's exactly the paper by Nishit. But, well, you can still try to harass him in the corridor, maybe he will.
We wouldn't have had this problem in the first place if you gave the talk that I said you were giving, right?
I concede this point, yes. Okay, so the other thing is that essentially we already have seen that electrical flow connect to like many different properties of random walks, but like, is there more? Like, are there any other, like some, you know, new things about random walks that we can compute quickly using electrical flow? So I don't know, but I hope they are. And finally, you know, this is just like, you know, like somehow the thing, again, these are just open directions. I don't have a convincing proof that this makes sense, but I believe it makes, is that somehow I think we should, you know, think whether the effective resistance metric is not a good way to look at your graph, you know, like, so far, usually we tend to, like, when you visualize a graph, or when you think about our graphs, we tend to use, like, shortest path metric. But shortest path metric is somehow, it's not, you know, it's not really robust. Like, in particular, you know, you might have things that are very disconnected, but then you add one edge, and suddenly everything becomes supposedly very well connected. Like, it seems that the notion of effective resistance metric is much more robust to this kind of, like, you know, like, it seems to capture connectivity in a more robust way. Again, you know, I know only one case when it helped, like the random spanning tree algorithm, but I have a feeling that it might be useful in other contexts as well. So that's something to explore. And finally, just as a, you know, like going beyond of what we know, is that essentially, like, you know, what can we do for directed graphs? Okay, and this is of course always the question that, you know, if you want to, people working on algorithms or graph algorithms, if you want to puzzle them, you always ask about directed graph. So I ask about this as well. You know, can you, for instance, can you compute directed electrical flows? We can always define directed electrical flows as just, you know, you do L2 minimization over the space of directed flows, and you know, can you find, you know, it's not clear how to compute such a flow fast.
What if you want to spend m to the 3/2 time? Should be in
here. Yeah. This should work. Yes, like if you just, but you know, can you do under m to the 3/2 time?
So for example, do your flow, like, does your m to the 10/7 not apply to this type of problem?
I'm not sure, actually. Like, that's something that, you know, I have on the to-do list, but it might, but definitely it's not. You know, you have to actually carefully look if it's wrong, because like this objective is different. Like, my guess is yes, but it's not confirmed. So, but that would be the first point of start. But also, you can do it the other way. Like, once you find the better ways of computing directed flow, you can use it to compute max flow directly. So, you know, so this might be very interesting if you, maybe it's easier problem to think about. It's like usually L2 objectives are so far easier to think about than So, you know, that's an interesting, you know, that's an interesting direction to think about. I'm happy to talk with any of you more if you're interested. And the same goes, you know, to directed random walks. It's like that. I think some of you are thinking about this question, like, again, like stationary distribution of a directed random walk. It's like, at this point, you don't know anything. Can you get something out of it? They know something, so. But I think this is an interesting question to think about. I think they might, you know, highlight some new tools. Like somehow the problem is that linear algebra seems to be completely hopeless when you think about this question. But the language of optimization might just, you know, might just do something interesting. Okay, thank you. heavily over time, so I don't know.
One quick question. So if I take a random spanning tree in the complete graph, is that thin?
Random spanning tree in the complete, like it's log n over log n thin. Okay. It's actually it's one of the like or if it's tight, yes. So like if you take expanded, like actually the reason why it's tight is just if you look at one vertex and you look at the sampling there, like this, like the churn of upper bound is tight, like it's log n over log n, like so it's almost anything that you will do will always be tight.
Okay.